There is also another important aspect that you will use in your work during your future activities, and these are the simulations, the simulator. Here I have a number of very simple simulations that will show you something. This is, for example, the IV characteristics of for this device. This is another randomly selected device that I took from the web. This is another N-channel device. This is 300 volt device with a drain current of about 1 amp. This is the avalanche current. What is important for us is the on-state resistance. On-state resistance that is in the order of 0.81 ohm. This is the simulation. The simulation is very simple. Here you can see there is the IV characteristic simulated. And here I'm simulating the transfer characteristic connecting the drain to the source, to the gate. Here we are simulating a parametric analysis on VGS and on VGS, yes. Running the simulation, we can see the IV characteristics and the transfer characteristic. Okay, the transfer characteristic, as you can see, will start at about 2 volts. And as a matter of fact, the threshold voltage is 2 volts here. And this shows that this model, this is a SPICE model of the device, this is not the real device. It looks good with the threshold voltage. What we can see from the on-state resistance is we can measure the on-state resistance. And it is quite simple, just adding one cursor here. Let's say 10 volts, 13 amps. The on-state resistance is 10 volts divided 14, more or less, divided 14. This is 0.7. This is 0.7. This is 0.7 ohms. That is not quite the value that we saw on the datasheet. It's slightly smaller. This is the first difference that we notice. Another aspect that we can see from the... This is written here. We can see 0.71 ohm is the on-state resistance. Actually, this is also... There is this dot measure that calculates the on-state resistance, let's see. Yes, the on-state resistance that goes from 0.8 to 0.71 when VGS, and you can see as a function of VGS does not change much when you move from 10 to 20 volts. And for VGS equal 3 volts is larger, but not huge. However, it is different from the datasheet. And this is also interesting because the on-state resistance in this for this device is claimed as 1 ohm, but the simulation tells us that it is smaller. Another point that you can see is that if we analyze these IV characteristics here, these look like the typical IV characteristic of a MOSFET. However, you can see that here there is quite a big resistance. This is too linear. And this can be shown calculating the saturation voltage. For example, let's say that VGS is 10 volts. The simulation shows that saturation voltage is 14.9 volts. Sorry, this should be 6. Let's see. Let's select this 6 volt VGS. Okay. There is something wrong in this simulation. Just a moment. Let's see. Let's select the 10 volts. Okay, for 10 volts, the saturation voltage is around 14-15 volts. Now, we do expect that the saturation voltage is VGS minus VT. That should be 8 volts. Is it okay? Now, we can assume that the extra voltage is the voltage drop on the epilayer resistance that is in series with the MOSFET. We can then calculate the voltage drop on the epilayer resistance and hence calculating the epilayer resistance, assuming that this extra voltage between 8 volts and 14 volts, 15 volts, is the epilayer voltage drop. Once we do this calculation, we get the epilayer resistance is 0.38 ohms. And also, we can use the same value to estimate the saturation voltage when VGS is 6 volts. And we get that saturation voltage is more or less 7 volts instead of being 4. Like we expected. In this case, we can also estimate the on-state resistance, the epilayer resistance, and most important, this curve here are actually very much influenced by the epilayer resistance that is limiting the current increase here. We can also simulate the to see if the device is properly modeled. Let's see. Let's see if we can run a simulation in reverse condition and see if we have a diode in parallel. Okay, this is the reverse current. This is negative. Let's plot this in a positive direction. As you can see, this is a diode. 0.5 volt, 0.6 volts. And this increase here is not exponential, but is very much resistive because this is a diode, yes, but we have the epilayer resistance. This is a PIN diode. We quite soon enter in the resistive region. The current conduction of this device is good, but not exceptional. As you can see, 2.7 amps, and we are yet to 1.8 volts. Okay, this shows us that the device is quite good model with the SPICE model for the IV characteristics. The on-state resistance is not very close to what we expect. Actually, it is smaller than the typical value in the datasheet, and this can be a problem. Let's simulate another aspect of this device, the gate charge. And it's not this device, this is another device, but also in this case we have the structure. The gate charge is indicated as total gate charge 70 amps, 70 nanocoulombs. And here you can see the test conditions that are shown in this final page. This is the unclamped inductive test. This is the gate charge circuit. This is the waveform. We can simulate the gate charge condition using exactly the circuit that they suggest. This is the device. As you can see in the parameters, the gate charge is 70 nanocoulombs, like the same value shown on the datasheet. And this is the test circuit. We can simulate the charge. The waveform is what we expect, zero up to a certain point, then it starts, increases more or less constant up to this value, and then increases again. With the measured combat, we can calculate the charge, that is 57 nanocoulombs, not 70. Also in this case, the model does not look like very precise if compared with the datasheet. We can now simulate the inductive load switch for this circuit. This is not to analyze the behavior against the datasheet, but just to show that the device is working exactly like, at least in simulation, exactly like we showed during the lecture. This is shown here. In this case, the inductor has been simulated with a current generator in order to avoid the charging time of the inductor. And this is the device behavior. As you can see, during turn on, the current increases, and only after the voltage decreases. And during turn off, the same. The voltage increases, and only after the current decreases. The current increase and decrease are more or less linear, very steep. On the other hand, the voltage increase here starts very slow and finishes fast with a large derivative, and the opposite happens during turn on, as we expected. The gate voltages here vary from 0 volts to 15 volts, start with a linear slope, stop around here when you charge the gate to drain capacitance, and then finish up to 15, and vice versa during this phase. Here it is also shown the gate current. This is a capacitance charge, and we do expect that the charge that you use to charge the capacitance is the same that you extract. As you can see, there is a positive current during the charging and a negative current during the discharge. Probably integrating this charge, you get a value very close to zero. There is some measurement. Okay, we are just integrating the charge from the current, the RG current during the switch, to show that this is very, very smooth. And finally, the last test that I want to show you is the unclamped inductive switch. Okay, the device is the same. The circuit is more or less the same. The only difference here, I have the inductor and I don't have the freewheeling diode. Okay, now what we are simulating is that we switch on the device, we charge the current into the inductor, then we switch off the device and see what happens. We do expect that when we switch off the device, the voltage increases up to 200 volts. This is the breakdown voltage. We'll stop at 200 volts, we'll stay at 200 volts for a while, and then it goes down to zero. very confident. We run the simulation. And this is what we see. Okay, this simulation has been stopped just in order to show you just the turn-off phase. The current is increasing. The current reaches more or less 1 amp. That is the rated current of this IRFP240. No, it is 20 amps. Okay, but this is not much larger than the rated current. We are not overloading the device. And when I switch off the device, the voltage increases and the maximum value is up to 4 kilovolts. Why? What's happening? Actually, this model does not include breakdown. Our MOSFET model for the simulation does not include breakdown. Hence, what we see is that when you switch off the device, this voltage increases up to a very large value in order to reduce the current into the inductor up to the moment in which the current goes to zero. The current, the voltage increase, the derivative depends on the gate current or inductor current that charges the gate-to-drain capacitance, the drain-to-source capacitance, and this is what we see, which is the warning that I want to give you with these simulations. I want to show you that what we have seen is also possible to simulate, but I want to tell you that power device models are a very tricky question. I mean, power device models are useful in typical conditions. When you want to simulate strange conditions, the first question that you have to ask yourself is the model good enough for the simulation that I want to run? In this case, the breakdown is included. As you can see, I didn't make this model. I took it from the library, and there is no breakdown voltage included. Okay? And this can happen for other things. For example, the temperature dependence of the devices. This is usually not included in these simulations. And you need to be careful. Every time you see that the simulation, you cannot run the simulation and trust the simulation like it is. You first need to ask, is the circuit modeling exactly what I'm doing? Is the device model good enough? If the results are the results physically sound? Because there is also a numerical simulator that can give you problems. This is the message that I want to give you with these simulations. This concludes our lecture.